don't know. All right, any announcements this morning? Anybody, anything? I know that if you were doing a shoebox for the Operation Shoebox, they need them today. And I'm not sure where exactly they're collecting them, but they're going today. Just a personal announcement, not this coming Friday, but a week from this Friday, on November 30th, we're having our CD release party, our latest CD on Christmas CD. And we're celebrating that by having a fundraiser for America's Second Harvest. It's going to be over on the Ritz on Friday, November 30th, from 7 to 9 p.m. We're asking for a $5 admission fee and a non-perishable food item, and all the proceeds for that are going to go to America's Second Harvest. If you've all been reading the paper, you know that they have been suffering. All the food pantries are suffering. That's why Ed family and the church took up food last week. You know, the need is up and the donations are down. So if you can come to that or make a donation, that would be awesome. Have we got other announcements?
Yeah, let me just make a couple real quick. Be sure to turn in. You haven't turned in haven't turned in a card. that's going to be tough to deal with. If you haven't turned in a commitment card, please do that. And next Sunday, of course, is going to be the Sunday after Thanksgiving, but it's not the first Sunday of Advent. So next Sunday is going to be not a youth Sunday, but Shannon is going to preach one. We're going to be in Pennsylvania. Please keep us in your prayers if you would. My mother's going to have a pacemaker implanted on Tuesday. We're leaving Monday after school to go up to Pennsylvania and drive straight through. So keep us in your prayers and drive straight through. And then her surgery is going to be on Tuesday. And then hopefully back out and home by Thanksgiving. So then we'll be taking them to Kentucky at the end of the week. So keep us in your prayers as we travel. And again, Shannon will be preaching next week. And we'll be back the following week. And on the 28th, I believe it is. 28th is Charge Conference. 29th. Is Thursday. I think that's when the Chrismon tree is going up in the sanctuary, and Friday the 30th is going to be decoration. That's going to be a work day. So if you got any time, you can come by and help us do the decoration. That's when Edie Payne will be leading the worship committee, and we'll be doing decorations for the church for Advent. Okay? Okay, thanks.
Well, did you want to give an update on the Buffies, by chance?
On what?
On the Buffies.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah,
I'm
sure.
I have a feeling that's an electrical thing here. Stephen Buffy, I talked to Viviana last night, and he had his surgery, and she said it's hard for me to talk to communicate with Viviana over the phone especially, but as I understand it, the surgery went well, but Stephen is in a lot of pain, so that's where the problem is right now. So keep Stephen in your prayers. They took the top of his head off and were able to operate on the tumors. What kind of result that gets us, I don't know. At this point, I don't think they fully understand either. So just keep them in your prayers. They hope to be home this next week, I think. So we're just kind of, I touch base with her every day. And just keep Stephen in your prayers.
Anything else? Anybody? Any announcements? All right, then, as you're willing, as you're able, will you stand and join us? Our first song this morning is one we did last week. It's The Power of Your Name.
Surely children weren't made for the street. Thank you. beyond religion to see the world be changed by the power of your name. The power of your name. Surely life wasn't made to regret, and the lost were not made to forget. Surely faith without action is dead. Let your kingdom come. Lord, break this heart, and I will live to carry your compassion, to love a world that's broken, to be your hands and feet. And I will give with the life that I've been given, and go beyond religion to see the world be changed by the power of your name. Jesus, your name is a shelter for the hurting, and your name is a refuge for the weak. Only your name can redeem the undeserving. Jesus, your name holds everything I need, and I will live to carry your compassion, to love a world that's broken, to be your hands and feet.
Yes, I believe we are. Good morning. Which one are you in, Mr. Cross? Remember?
Oh, okay. Sorry.
We're going to take up our offering now, a chance for us to offer back to God a small portion of what He has graced us with this week. Once again, will you stand and join us? Our next hymn is going to be In Christ Alone. If you don't know it, although it's a contemporary song, it sounds fairly traditional. I promise you'll catch on straight away.
No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I'll stand.
But only through your love. We are so weak, Lord. We are fragile. We are frail. We are lost without you. But with your power, we can do all things. You are what strengthens us. Your power is what guides us. Your hand. Lord, help us remember. Help us remember that. That without you, we can do nothing. But with you, we can do all the things you call us to do. And you call us to do more. You call us to be your hands and feet. Help us, Lord. Lord, this week in particular, we want to say thank you. We should be saying thank you all the time. But this week in particular, we want to say thank you for the many blessings that you give us. The ones we see, the ones we don't see, the ones we're aware of, and the ones we so easily forget, Lord. We have family, we have friends, we have a church. We have a country that we're safe. We have a world that gives us so much, and you have given all that to us. But Lord, there's some people who don't know that there's so many blessings more around them. Help us. Help us share that to them. Help us be your hands. Thank you. In Jesus' name.
Sunday, so everybody remember what a third Sunday means? Lots of good things to eat in the Welcome Center. Plus, we have a 5 dozen contribution by Denver Donuts this morning. Anyway, sounds neat. Looks good. Okay, we have a special group number that we're going to present this morning. Now, there's a group in our church called Tuck and Jim. You know what? I got a question. I'm bigger than you. Why do you get top billing? Why does your name come up? We are going to sing a song this morning. It takes Tuck and I. Come on up, Tuck. Tuck picks out our music, and we work on it, and when we get ready, then we turn it loose. And this is the third, and before too long, we are going to have enough to make a CD. Tuck and Jim CD. Okay. Now, I'm going to go get Kelly. You ready? You ready? job, Tuck. Okay, and indeed it is, praise of the Lord with all of your heart. They asked Jesus about that time tripping one day, didn't they? What's the greatest commandment? Now, today is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, and so I've got some Thanksgiving humor. That has already elicited a response. Let's see. Okay, what did the mama turkey say to her naughty son? If your papa could see you now, he'd turn over in his grave. Let's see. Why do turkeys always gobble? No, because they haven't been taught good manners, good table manners. Okay. Why did the turkey cross the road? Because it was the chicken's day off. Yeah. Okay. What did the turkey say before it was roasted? Boy, I'm stuffed. Say it with me. Boy, I'm stuffed. There you go. Okay. Thanksgiving humor. Very little. Now, I love this, though. Listen to this, y'all. This is hilarious. A man in Phoenix calls his son in New York the day before Thanksgiving and says, I hate to ruin your day. Remember, he's talking to his son. I hate to ruin your day, but I have to tell you that your mother and I are divorcing. 45 years of misery is enough. Pop, what are you talking about? The son screams. We can't stand the sight of each other any longer, the father says. We're sick of each other. I'm sick of talking about this. So call your sister in Chicago and tell her. Frantic, the son calls his sister, who explodes on the phone. Like heck, they're getting divorced, he shouts. I'll take care of this. She calls Phoenix immediately and screams at her father, you are not getting divorced. Don't do a single thing until I get there. I'm calling my brother back and we'll both be there tomorrow. Until then, don't do a thing. Do you hear me? And hangs up. The old man hangs up the phone, turns to his wife. Okay, he says, they're coming for Thanksgiving and paying their own way. Isn't that pretty good? I like that. I thought that was great. Okay, today is, and Sue's got the children's group, they're going to be reciting this as a text. And when I heard that they wanted to do this, I thought, you know, that is probably, I've got a sermon on the 100th Psalm, so that would be perfect for Thanksgiving, because it's one of the beautiful psalms. There are psalms that are categorized, and of course the longest chapter in the Bible is 119th Psalm, and there are 150 of them, and they have different categories. They can be used for different things, encouragement and different things, the crying out from deep remorse because of what David went through and so on, various situations in his life, including being chased by his own son and all the things that happened with Bathsheba and so on. So anyway, Psalm 100 is known as one of the beautiful psalms, okay? And this is it. It's just simply five verses. It says this, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people. We are the sheep and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting and his truth endures to all generations. And may God add a blessing of understanding to the reading of his word. This is a period of time of year, and Thanksgiving is a uniquely American holiday. I think you're aware of that. Was started, you know, President Washington, after getting elected the first president of the United States, declared a day of Thanksgiving, I think, in 1778 first. Of course, Governor Bradford in 1621 declared a day of Thanksgiving after that very, very fierce winter of 1620. And I like what somebody said, though. The very fact that a man wants to be thankful means that he's got someone to be thankful to. Now, I can't go through a Thanksgiving without reminding you. We do this at our place for Thanksgiving. This is a Thanksgiving custom that we have. We started it years ago when I first read this. And you know, I'm a history major, and there are history facts that I really enjoy. But I cannot go through Thanksgiving without reminding you that things got so bad on that first winter. Nearly more than half, a few more than half of that first colony died in a very, very fierce winter. The conditions were terrible. They soon ran out of food. They had not grown anything the summer before. They got here in the fall of the year. The winter in Massachusetts was fierce. There was no, you know, they knew very little about flora and fauna in the area. Of course, there wasn't any flora. But they knew very little about the animals, and so for 2 weeks, a stretch of 2 weeks in January of 1621, there was a time when the daily ration had gotten down to 5 kernels of corn. That's the daily ration. 5 kernels of corn. They passed out 5 kernels of corn, and when they passed them out, every time, there were 14 days there, because finally somebody trapped a turkey, and I don't know how you trap a turkey in the snow, but that's what they did. They actually trapped it. They didn't shoot it. They trapped it, and that's was the beginning of food that began to be supplied to the community there. But every time they passed out those 5 kernels of corn, they bowed their heads and gave thanks. And you know, we'll sit down to what kind of a meal will we have on Thanksgiving. Irma Bombeck, I wonder what Irma Bombeck said. She said, it takes 18 hours to prepare Thanksgiving dinner. She said, it takes 12 minutes to consume it.
Yeah.
She said, half times at football games are 12 minutes. This is not coincidence. That was pretty good. But, you know, the kind of meal that we'll sit down to on Thanksgiving, we'll enjoy wonderful repasts. And we'll have, you know, we'll have our choice. We'll have our choice. But for people not to have a choice except to take 5 kernels of corn, they would put them together, they would mash them up, they might make one biscuit out of 3 or 4 of them, divide that 4 ways. You know, there just isn't much you can do with 5 kernels of corn. That's all they had. And every time they bowed, prayed for God's provision, but thank God that they were alive and for what they had. So we put 5 kernels of corn at each plate. That's how we begin our Thanksgiving meal, because we want to remember what people went through, especially what people went through to help us found this country. Now, in this psalm, I think there are 3 things that are the key. The first 3 verses of Psalm 100 are unique because they give us a key to an attitude of gratitude in life. You know, we've heard people use that catchphrase, an attitude of gratitude. Some people, you can tell, live with an attitude of being thankful in lives. Other people, you know, you wonder how they exist. You wonder how their spirit survives. And God doesn't just want our spirit to survive. He wants our spirit to thrive. He wants us to live in fullness of joy. He wants us to experience a full repast. He doesn't just want us to have a good Thanksgiving meal, but the word says, in his presence are pleasures. And at thy right hand is fullness of joy, the psalmist said in Psalm 95 and verse 11. So God wants us to have fullness of joy. God wants us to experience good things. He wants us to be and to serve him out of thankfulness. Now, there are 3 things that I see in these first 3 verses. The last 2 verses are what the goal is, what we're actually shooting for. And that is to enter into his thanksgiving, into his gates with thanksgiving, to come into his presence and to be glad about coming into his presence. But there are 3 things that we need to understand. The first is this: an attitude of gratitude comes from, first of all, serving the Lord with gladness. Serving the Lord with gladness. If you're doing the little fill-in blank on the bulletin there, the blanks are serving, Lord, and gladness. Serving the Lord with gladness. And this is what the psalmist really says, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all of you lands. This is the first step. Serving the Lord with gladness. You know, we came through this past weekend where we had the mission fair. And again, you've heard me thank Barry. Barry worked very hard on getting the mission fair. Marianna worked hard cooking spaghetti that night, too, for us for the dinner on Friday night. Tim and Annie gave a concert, and we had a wonderful, wonderful time. But in that mission fair this year, there were 25 opportunities for service in the kingdom of God. Last year when we had the mission fair in here, we had 17 or 18 booths in here. This year we have 25. I'm hoping that we get the attitude in the church that we see that in the fall, when we do, when we come to this time of commitment, when we come to this time of looking for opportunities to serve the Lord, that we'll take advantage of it and be willing to sign up and to participate in ministry. It was great to talk to these people. I mean, everything from the Benjamins who work in Haiti, who do the things that they do in Haiti, such a desolate and still, you know, it's off the public radar now. It's off of our radar screen. We don't see nightly pictures on the news of the devastation in Haiti. But Haiti is absolutely the slowest to recover from a disaster. And when that earthquake hit a couple of years ago, it has continued to devastate the country of Haiti. There are opportunities to serve. We need to be looking for opportunities to serve the Lord. We need, as a church, to be looking for opportunities to serve the Lord in the church. Now, when I say that, I don't mean to say that there's not good service going on now. There is. There's wonderful service going on. I could recount to you, and Susan was talking a little bit this morning when she first came in, about attitudes that she's seen developing and growing of how people are reaching out to one another. I want to thank you all for your support of Stephen and Vivian Buffy and the girls. Now, Stephen had his surgery, and we need to pray for him. They took the top of his head off. Now, I can't quite get the full detailed report from Vivian, so I don't know. She said, the doctor said the surgery went well, but that he's in a great deal of pain, and they're trying to decide how they're going to treat the pain. So that's, you know, this church has really rallied behind the Buffets. And this is a difficult time. This is a difficult time for them. All of that to say that there are opportunities to serve. We just need to open our eyes. The thing is that I want you to understand that there will come a day, and this is Matthew 25, when we will stand before God and he'll ask us how we've served him. What have we done in service to the kingdom? You see, the church, this church is a ecclesia. It's a gathering of the faithful. It's a place where we share love together. It's a place where we fellowship and worship. But it is a place to serve in the kingdom of God. It is a place to actually do something in the kingdom of God. Now, here's the thing. Here's part of the understanding of how we develop an attitude of gratitude, an attitude of willingness to serve him and to be happy. But he says, serve the Lord with gladness. Do you choose to be happy? Do you choose to be sad? Now, there are things that happen, there are circumstances that happen that cause us grief, and we understand that we pass through periods of grief and mourning. But you know, I wonder about people who live in sadness, whose life seems to be overcome, and they walk around like the children of Israel followed that cloud by day through the wilderness. Some people to me seem to be walking about underneath the cloud of sadness in their lives. And that's a frustrating thing. I think that's a frustrating thing to God, because regardless of the circumstances that we go through, regardless of the hills, regardless of the valleys, he wants us to serve him with gladness. Sometimes I have this little prayer that I think about, particularly when I've been in the presence of somebody who just doesn't seem to quite get it, as far as what it means to serve him the Lord with gladness. And I want to say, Lord, I hope aging isn't a process to get me. Does that make sense? I'm getting to be an old geezer. You know? I just don't want the attitude that sometimes seems to attach itself to us as we move through life. Lord, keep me happy in you. Keep me glad in you. Serve the Lord. The psalmist says, serve the Lord with gladness. I think that there's a door that opens inside when we realize that it's our choice. We can serve the Lord with an ugly attitude, or we can serve him with gladness. And this is the first step into an attitude of gratitude. Serve the Lord with gladness. Then secondly, he says, come before his presence. presence with singing. There is such a thing. I want you to hear this morning because I think it's important to our understanding of how we worship together. There is such a thing as being in the presence of God. Now, we can step back and say, well, the presence of God is everywhere. You know, the psalmist said, I can't ascend to the mountaintop or I can't go down to the deepest parts of the ocean without being in the presence of God. Oh, that's exactly right, because Ecclesiastes tells us that by the presence of his strength, all things are held together. But there is such a thing as being in the presence of God when we recognize that presence and when our hearts are turned to worship him, recognizing that he is in our midst. And this is why Jesus told us that when two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm going to be there among you. Now, the presence that is among us is the Holy Spirit of God, who points to Jesus. But there is a presence into which we come. Now, when we recognize that there is a presence, and the psalmist said this, in your presence, this is in Psalm 16:11, if you want to jot this down, in your presence is fullness of joy, at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Do you know why I think that some people come into church and leave the same way that they came in? Is because that they don't really realize that they've been in the presence of God. You have to recognize that presence. You see, I stand on the promise as a pastor of this church. When I come in to teach or to preach the word of God, I stand on the promise that he made. That if we're gathered together in his name, that he's going to be here. I believe that you can come in here and not recognize that presence. And leave without ever having realized that you've been in that presence. Listen. The psalmist, David, was so aware of being in the presence of God. Now, that didn't keep him from falling. It didn't keep him from being at fault in several important things in his life. And God would take him, and he would twist him, and he would turn him, and he would do things to him that you don't want done to you, and that I don't want done to me, but that he needed to hear, see, and be a part of if he was going to continue to be in the presence of God. He said, in your presence is fullness of joy, your right hand of pleasures forevermore. The psalmist wanted to live in that and to experience that, and yet there were times when he was disobedient. Now, listen to this. In the 51st chapter, in one of those times of disobedience, he said, Lord, cast me not from your presence. Cast me not from your presence. In other words, he knew that he had done something that was disobedient. He knew that he had aggrieved God. He knew that he had failed God. And yet, where do we find forgiveness? Where do we find the ability to continue with that presence and in that presence? It's when we ask forgiveness and move on. And God grants us forgiveness. The psalmist says, come before his presence with singing. You don't bring a poor attitude into God's presence. You know, I often hear coaches talk about bringing your A game. We're going to have to have our A game. We're going to have to bring our A game. You don't need to bring your A game when you come into the presence of God. Last night, there were a couple of huge games. Kansas State, oh my goodness, I was amazed. Went down there on the 1 yard line, that big old quarterback that Kansas State has. And you know what? Baylor said, not this time. And four downs they held him inside the 10-yard line. Now that's your A game. You see, that's an underdog playing the number one ranked team in the nation and stood up to them. And it was incredible. It was an amazing upset. You don't bring a poor attitude into the presence of God. What did the psalmist later, after learning so many lessons in life, what did he say? A merry heart is what? It doeth good like a medicine. A merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Now, last thing, the third point that I want you to hear from this psalm. Know that the Lord, He is God. Now listen to how he expands on this and unpacks this verse for us. Know that the Lord, He is God. It is He who has made us and not we ourselves. Do you know, I think that there are many people who don't experience the fullness of God and the joy in His presence and the pleasures at His right hand because they think they're self-made. There is an attitude of gratitude that comes from the heart that says, Lord, what I have you give me, and I'm grateful. Listen, there's an attitude of gratitude that a nation ought to have. And we, among all nations of this earth, ought to have this attitude. Lord, we are who we are because of your blessing. If we think we're a self-made nation, we are not going to be at the pinnacle very long. Now, there is huge responsibility that comes with that. We don't all agree how that needs to work out in the world. And I'm telling you right now, the Middle East is sitting on the verge of bursting into flame. But aren't we thankful that we don't have to worry about missiles coming from Canada into this country? Aren't we thankful that we don't have to worry about missiles coming from Mexico into Texas? Remember what almost happened in Cuba? I remember getting under my desk in Boca Grande, Florida, when my daddy was the pastor of the Methodist Church on Boca Grande, just out from Fort Myers. Beautiful night. One of the prettiest places on the west coast of Florida. Tarpon fishing capital of the world. And I remember as a fifth grader and a sixth grader, same classroom. We had both grades in one classroom on the island. Only had 11 kids in both schools. And I remember when time came for the missile drills, and we'd get under our desks and wait for the drill sign to be over. One day some boys took a gallon jug, and when we still had the high school on the island, fifth grade year, and I'm going to tell you this, I probably shouldn't say this, but there's not a lot of juveniles here, and there's certainly no juvenile delinquents, but they cut all the match heads off of a bunch of matches and put them into a gallon jar, and they exploded down in the hallway. Now, we had porticos in outdoor hallways. They weren't enclosed hallways, but some high school kids set that thing off. Now, for a bunch of little fifth graders and sixth graders, we thought the Cuban Missile Crisis had come to pass when they exploded that thing in the hallway. First thing we did, teacher made us get under our desks. We thought the missiles were raining down from the sky. And, you know, I can't help but when I look at those missile pods being fired, and Israel trying to protect itself with these things coming down from the sky, and the imminent invasion of Gaza by Israeli troops. Now there's an answer to it. I don't know that we're going to be able to find it right away, but there is an answer. But I'm just grateful that my children don't have to live like that. I have stood in the bomb crater of the largest kibbutz in Israel, the oldest kibbutz in Israel, that you can look up and see the Golan Heights when they were controlled by the Syrians, and the fact that tanks could shoot their shells into this kibbutz in the 60s and all the way up until 1973. And I stood in that bomb, in those craters. I looked up at the Golan Heights, and I'm grateful that we don't have to experience that here as a nation. Part of understanding that joy and having an attitude of gratitude is knowing that the Lord is God and we are not self-made. And listen, if we can understand these three points, first of all, that we serve the Lord with gladness, we come into His presence with thanksgiving, we know that the Lord, He is God, then, in verse 4 and 5, then we can enter His gates with thanksgiving and into His courts with praise. We can be thankful to Him and bless His name, for the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures to all generations. Be truly thankful. I really believe, as I wrote on the front of the newsletter, it's possible to be thankful for some things without an attitude of thanksgiving. We can be thankful, but we ought to give our thanks to God Almighty, who has given to us. Come closest.
Our closing song this morning, if you'll stand and join us as you're willing, as you're able. Our closing song is Thank You, Lord.
Thanks.